On October 9th, 2019, Turkey and Turkish-backed forces moved into northern Syria after President Trump ordered the withdrawal of U.S. forces there. For Turkey, the goal is twofold: to eliminate an existential security threat and also to create a so-called safe zone, where Turkey plans on resettling around 2 million of the 3.6 million Syrian refugees residing in Turkey. Observers say that this could potentially significantly change the demographic along the Syria-Turkey border, but it's also Turkey's way of addressing the growing resentment among the Turkish population towards Syrian refugees. Experts are likening Turkey's incursion into Syria to what happened back in 1974 when Turkey acted unilaterally in its operation in Cyprus. Back then, Washington was focused on Watergate and Nixon. Today, the focus is on Trump, impeachment, and the general lack of policy that gave Turkey an opportunity.
Doing a very good job.
The fight against the PKK and its offshoots do create rare political unity in what is otherwise a very polarized country. This gives Erdogan the chance to rally the country behind him, which is important, especially since his AKP party suffered some pretty bitter blows in the local elections that were held most recently in both Ankara and Istanbul. For decades, the Turkish state has been battling the PKK, and tens of thousands of lives have been lost. Back in the mid-1980s, which is when the insurgency began in earnest, PKK fighters had camps inside northern Syria. It's not just Turkey that considers the PKK to be a terrorist organization, so does the United States and the European Union. Now, the PYD, which is basically an offshoot or sister organization to the PKK, was established in 2003. Its armed wing is the YPG. From Turkey's perspective, there is no difference between the PKK and the YPG. Both are terrorist organizations. With the fight against ISIS and the U.S. then partnering with the YPG, Turkey all of a sudden found most of its southern border being dominated by an enemy. Ultimately, the big winner in all of this is actually Russia. Russia has achieved one of its main aims: to get the Americans out of Syria. For the Syrian regime, it's now back in territory it has not controlled for years. And for Turkey, it might be a bit of a bitter pill, but one that Turkey can actually swallow. If the regime moves in and ends up controlling the border, at least the threat, the security threat against Turkey will be eliminated. But Turkey's aim had been to remove Bashar al-Assad from power. Turkey may now have to...
Let's begin with a false claim made by the acting chief of staff, Mick Mulvaney.
Yeah, you know, we can spend so much time drowning in Trump's dishonesty that we can forget about dishonesty from members of his team. So listen to what the acting chief of staff said at his now infamous press briefing yesterday.
Also mentioned to me in the past that the corruption related to the DNC server, absolutely, no question about that. But that's it, and that's why we held up the money.
What got most of the attention here was Mulvaney essentially admitting to a quid pro quo. What got less attention was that there is no corruption in Ukraine related to the DNC server that was hacked in 2016. This is a debunked conspiracy theory that rests on two things that are not true at all. One is the suggestion that the co-founder of a cybersecurity firm was born in Ukraine. He was born in Russia. And the second is that Ukraine has somehow taken possession of the DNC server. And that is simply not the case. That server exists in the United States still today.
And in fact, Republican Congressman Francis Rooney just told us as much. Republican Congressman, a few minutes ago, Daniel. So last night, the president had this big rally in Texas and made a false claim about the whistleblower.
Yeah, so of those 129 last week, the most frequent, 11 times, was a claim that the whistleblower was totally inaccurate. Listen to what he said last night.
What about the whistleblower? The whistleblower got it all wrong.
Trump is getting this all wrong. The whistleblower made three primary allegations about Trump's call with Ukraine's president. All three of those claims were correct. The whistleblower said Trump pressed Zelensky to investigate the Bidens, correct, to speak to Rudy Giuliani and Attorney General Barr, correct, and to look into this debunked conspiracy with regard to the server. So that is all accurate. The server made a couple of other claims that may be considered inaccurate, but we don't have the full story yet. And all of his main allegations were indeed correct.
By the way, there was a report that we worried that the money wouldn't, if we didn't pay out the money, it would be illegal. Okay, it would be unlawful. That is one of those things that has that little shred of truth in it that makes it look a lot worse than it really is. We were concerned about, over at OMB, about an impoundment. And I know I just put half of you folks to bed, but there's the Budget Control Act, Budget Control Impoundment Act of 1974 says that if Congress appropriates money, you have to spend it. Okay, at least that's how it's interpreted by some folks. And we knew that that money either had to go out the door by the end of September, or we had to have a really, really good reason not to do it. And that was the legality of the issue.
But to be clear, what you just described is a quid pro quo. It is funding will not flow unless the investigation into the Democratic server happened as well.
We do that all the time with foreign policy. We were holding up money at the same time for, what was it, the Northern Triangle countries. We were holding up aid at the Northern Triangle countries so that they would change their policies on immigration. By the way, and this speaks to an important point, because I heard this yesterday, and I can never remember the gentleman who testified. Was it McKinney, the guy? Is that his name? I don't know him. He testified yesterday. And if you go, and if you believe the news reports, okay, because we've not seen any transcripts of this. The only transcript I've seen was Sondland's testimony this morning. If you read the news reports and you believe them, what did McKinney say yesterday? Well, McKinney said yesterday that he was really upset with the political influence in foreign policy. That was one of the reasons he was so upset about this. And I have news for everybody. Get over it. There's going to be political influence in foreign policy. I'm talking to Mr. Carl. That is going to happen. Elections have consequences, and foreign policy is going to change from the Obama administration to the Trump administration. And what you're seeing now, I believe, is a group of mostly career bureaucrats who are saying, you know what, I don't like President Trump's politics, so I'm going to participate in this witch hunt that they're undertaking on the Hill. Elections do have consequences, and they should, and your foreign policy is going to change. Obama did it in one way, we're doing it a different way, and there's no problem with that.
We've historically had a very good relationship with Oracle. They're a very key partner of ours, and we hope for that to continue for many years to come.
The change in the business model, again, you're going to see this geometric incline in the amount of speed that you see pick up